All right, it's so good to see all of your beautiful faces. Now, I have to admit, I'm a little bit nervous today, so I hope you don't mind that I brought a little friend along. Hi, Ted. Okay, if you didn't hear him, Ted, my jacket, just said, hi, Emelie. Oh, so relieved. It's moments like this, I'm so glad that I sewed Ted into my jacket. Hello, all. I'm Emelie Eldracher, a senior undergraduate in computation and cognition. And today, we're going to be investigating TinyML, or tiny machine learning. And that's putting the power of big machine learning on something smaller than your fingernail. Right there. All right, after the next 8 minutes, you're all going to know how we build a TinyML program, why that's so exciting, and hopefully walk away with a couple ideas of your own. So to start us off, who here has seen one of the more recent Spider-Man movies where MIT alum Tony Stark was the designer of the Spider-Man suit? Yeah, oh, I heard some enthusiasm back there. There we go. Seeing a couple nods. Well, for those of you who said no, and those of you who said yes, all you need to know is that the name of Spider-Man's suit is Karen, and Karen helps Spider-Man do all the things a friendly neighborhood Spider-Man needs to do. She listens to him when he needs to talk, heats him up when he needs to dry off, and of course, puts him in instant kill mode when he asks. Now, I have parts of these three Karen capabilities in my jacket right now. And each of them is a machine learning model. The first is keyword spotting. The second is a regression-based neural network for temperature control. And the third is a motion classification system using a convolutional neural network where we turn motion into an image and then classify it. Okay, that was a lot of jargon going on right there. Let's rephrase. The first one hears everything I say, but only wakes up when he hears H-I-T-E-D. I don't want to wake him up right now. The second one takes in my activity and the external temperature and heats up to where I want to be. And the third recognizes when I throw a punch. Now, that's a lot of AI for these little microcontrollers. But that's the crux of what we're examining today, TinyML, and how that can influence our future. Ted wanted to say hello again. Now, over the past decade, we've all heard about the vast expansion of machine learning. As energy uses and machine learning cases develop, we've produced algorithms that take the comparable computing power of nuclear power plants to run. And now, we're looking at a way to do that with little memory and little space. How is that possible? Well, with TED, and by doing things that we did in order to reduce size in the past. So remember the first hard drive? Look at today's. Remember the first cell phone? That's me yesterday. We're doing something similar. But how is that possible, and where do we even begin with something like that? Well, we're going to start with a normal, large-size neural network. Then, we're going to shrink it down. How do we begin? Well, first, we're going to be removing redundant or unhelpful math. So using strategies such as pruning or knowledge distillation, we're removing neurons or weights, so the equations, all the math within that neural network, that take up space that don't necessarily have as big of an impact on the outcome. Next, we're going to round numbers to make it even smaller. So that means that using something called quantization, we're going to be going between numbers that take up more space to numbers that take up less space. Ooh, Ted doesn't want to keep saying hello. He keeps hearing his name, guys. Here we go. We're going to unplug Ted. He's getting too excited seeing all of you today. So back to rounding. We're going to be going between 64 or 32-bit integers to something like an 8-bit integer. This just means that we're condensing our model down smaller and smaller. Finally, we're going to do a little bit of translation. That means, just like how we would go maybe between Greek to English, we're going to be going between Python to C or C++. That's going between a language that we often use to train neural networks down to something that a microcontroller likes reading, something that Ted likes to read. And that, my friends, is how it winds up in my jacket. Now, that was a lot of technical side of things. Why do we even care at all? Well, there are three tiny points about TinyML that will make a big impact in tomorrow's world. Privacy, speed, and power. Let's start off with privacy. I don't want anyone knowing when I decide to say hello to Ted, and I definitely don't want anyone knowing when I decide to break out and start practicing my karate moves. I don't want to be sending my information to a server 3,000 miles away. Well, with TinyML, it can all stay right here on board. I don't need to send data out for analyzation. It can be done right here with me. That means our data stays right here with us. Second is speed. Second is going to be speed. So think about what we just said. We don't need to be sending out information. That means that we cut the transmit times absolutely down to zero. If everything's on board here with us, we don't need that in-between time between servers or our own device. Now also think about all that shrinking that we just did, that quantization, that pruning, that knowledge distillation. That means that we're now running a pretty mean and lean algorithm, and it's going to be even faster than the original model. Now finally, if we don't need to be sending out information, that means that we don't need internet connection at all. Think about that. We can have AI without the need for the Wi-Fi. No one wants their jacket glitching out when the internet connection goes down. That would be even worse than the frozen faces during Zoom class, and I know we've all had that happen in the past year. Finally, is power. What kind of power do these algorithms use up anyway? Well, in 2019, research led by Carnegie Mellon's Emma Struble estimated that a single deep learning neural network can take up to 600,000 pounds of carbon emissions. That is the lifetime equivalent of 5 cars, or 17 adults for 1 year. That's a big friend group powering my man, Ted. And that's only during training. Technology company NVIDIA estimates that even more power is consumed during deployment. But let's think about where we're deploying. This is in my jacket right now. That means that we've lowered our energy consumption from that of the equivalent of nuclear power plants down to portable batteries. That means that we can take this anywhere on Earth, and without the need for internet connectivity and with some portable batteries like the one in my jacket right now, we can go anywhere. So by this point, you now know how we do this and kind of why it's important. Time for the fun part. What can we do with this? I'm standing before you in my jacket right now because I believe that the clothes we wear are our daily armor. What we put on becomes our next Spider-Man suit. That's how we tackle the challenges of the day. Now, that being said, maybe your next blazer doesn't need to know when you decide to start throwing punches. Maybe. I'm not making any assumptions here, but maybe. So in that event, what can we do? Now, I wish I had 100 examples to show you right now. But the truth of the matter is, this is the forefront of machine learning. Researchers and entrepreneurs are still discovering what's possible, what we can fit on such small chips, what kind of models we can use. So today, we're going to settle for 4. The jacket I'm wearing right now is a prototype made for Ministry of Supply for their mercury heating jacket. Now, another example is a wildfire identification system. Now, this system can identify when wildfires are beginning and can do so running completely on solar power. Another example uses low-cost microscopes in order to classify microorganisms, allowing doctors to take this type of data analyzation anywhere throughout the globe into the most inaccessible of places. And finally, right here at MIT in the Hahn Lab, we have an AI detection system that not only classifies images, such as chair, desk, computer, but can detect what's going on within an image. In this case, they use it to detect if someone was wearing a mask or not. Unfortunately, our time is coming to an end, which is tragic and so sad. I know you all are beginning to cry. So what is the main takeaway here? It's that this is the frontier of machine learning. It always feels like every single day there's a new AI program, there's a new machine learning program, and somehow, why are we always behind the trend? Why? Well, not today. Whether you go out and you design your own TinyML system, whether you have an idea for one leaving here today, or you just had a little bit of fun with me for the last 8 minutes, we are all pioneers of machine learning today. That is TinyML. Thank you.